If you will stand, we'll start our worship this morning with 205, Away in the Manger.
Day he's given us to come and to worship him. We are so thankful that you are here with us in house and also those of you joining us online. Maybe this is your first time either in house or online. We'd love to connect with you and be of any spiritual help we can to you and your relationship with Jesus Christ. You can just contact us there at welcome, 859-986-3444. For those of you in-house, we also have a little tear-off sheet that you can fill out some information that you don't mind us just reaching out to you and letting you know how wonderful it was to have you today. And you can just tear that out and put it in the offering plate as it is passed in just a while. John chapter 3, verses 16 through 19. For God loved the world in this way, he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Anyone who believes in him is not condemned, but anyone who does not believe in is already condemned, because he has not believed in the name of the one and only Son of God. This is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than the light because their deeds were evil. We celebrate God's love not only at Christmas, but should every day throughout our lives. And God proved his love for us, as it says in Romans chapter 5, that while we were still yet sinners, this Jesus that came, born of a virgin, gave his life for us and bore our sins at the cross, that we might be saved, that we might find redemption. This is the greatest act of love. And so today on this Lord's Day at Christmas and every day of our lives, let us rejoice that we are loved. You are loved by your Creator. And through his love for us, he has provided a way for us to be saved from a hopeless and wasted life to one day experience eternal blessings and glory, all that comes to us now and forever through Jesus Christ, the Savior. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful for this day. We are thankful, Lord, for this time of year as we even more consider your coming to us. We rejoice in it, Lord, and we thank you and worship you today, O Lord, because you first acted, not us, but you, Lord. You showed your love towards the world by sending your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, we give of our time, our minds, resources, and we worship you today. I do pray, Lord, for every part of this service, that it will be for your glory. And God, that you would help us today, Lord, to push out all the other worries and cares, anxieties in our life, the uncertainties. Help us to look upon the one certain thing in life, and that is you and your salvation. I ask these things in the name of our Savior and Lord. Amen. Brother Brandon, if you will, please come.
Good morning, Westside. It says in Matthew 2:1, now when Jesus was born, there came wise men from the east. So with that, let us sing our next hymn. If you will stand, will be 215, We Three Kings of Orient Are.
Follow me yonder song, Lord. mission work for the Great Commission Baptist goes much farther than temporarily sending a team into an area, knocking on doors, sharing the gospel, leading some to Christ and praying with them, and then leaving. These types of mission trips are good and needed, but as a Great Commission Baptist Church, we are strategic and support many missionaries for much more than just a pop-in. We send and we support missionaries that will live among a people, work among a people, eat and fellowship with them, and then slowly build relationships and trust, and all the while sharing the good news of Jesus. This was how Lottie Moon did it, giving her life for China a long time ago now. The Great Commission task is not an end to itself. It opens the door to friendship, to fruitful labor, to fellowship, and to faithfulness for a lifetime. There are many good deeds and ways to do ministry, but building trust and relationships is always the best, and it's the strongest way for making an eternal impact even when the missionary is gone from their work. You are now a part of this work through your prayers and giving faithfully, allowing missionaries to not just pop in, but to daily love a people with Jesus for many years. So thank you for giving, as we have already met and surpassed our goal of $2,000 here at Westside. You can still give through the end of the year, however. You can do that online, through our website, or through putting your offering in that specially marked envelope for Lottie Moon, and then dropping those in the church offering plate as it's passed this morning, or the little white church that we have in the foyer. So thank you for praying, and thank you for giving, and may you be blessed for doing so, and to God be the glory.
So what we want to do is just ask you about your time on the field.
Oh, I could tell stories upon stories.
Do I take the glasses off? Or?
All right.
We want the uncut version.
Okay.
I thought you were going to let me think about these questions before you ask them to me.
All right, you ready? First question. When you think back on your time overseas, what brings you joy?
It's the relationships, sharing of life, the sharing of who Jesus is. The greatest joy of my time overseas definitely is people.
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 It's the people.
People.
People that
the people that I got to meet.
The lives that were changed.
It's the people.
People.
It's definitely is people that flash before my eyes when I think about joy on the field.
What's one thing you wish you had known when you first went overseas that you know now?
You really are not in control.
I'm totally dependent on God.
My best efforts would never get it done.
Just been more genuine instead of more calculating.
How integral my kids could be in ministry in a developing country that was very close to the gospel.
How much the people become your family.
That if you're not passionate about reaching lostness where you are, it's not going to grow when you go to a foreign land.
To what degree did the Lottie Moon Christmas offering impact your work?
There is no way we could have gone where we went without Lottie Moon.
Tires were expensive to replace. I think he had the record in Kenya, changing 60 flats in 1 year.
Wheelchairs.
Textbooks.
Housing.
Surgery.
Solar panels.
Honda 185 motorcycle. It was kids on the back of this thing, motocross all the way to church on Sunday.
Torn Achilles, shoulder surgery. Without the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, I would be a mess.
You know, I never would have gotten to the field if it wasn't for the local church.
More than just an offering.
Every penny that was given.
Crucial, vital.
Literacy work.
Education opportunities.
A refugee center.
Health care.
We put in almost 300 wells.
Trained church planters.
Strategic.
Lifeline.
Cooperative effort
for the gospel around the world.
How has serving overseas changed you?
I think no one could have told me when I moved overseas what it was like to be a minority.
More sensitive to the needs of people around me.
Rather than seeing a people group, I see people.
more attuned to God's leadership,
ultimately confident in God.
In your opinion, what do you think church leaders could do to increase involvement overseas?
Marry the legacies of the past with the challenges of the future.
Model what it means. Go yourself.
People in the church will follow the example of their church leader.
Giving them a vision for missions, not just as something that happens when you get on an airplane, but helping them become stronger disciples of Christ in their own community.
If we're involved in global work, it will impact our local work.
He's brought the nations here.
Refugees, migrant workers.
Entrepreneurs looking for new ways to get into countries.
The opportunities really are limitless.
Last question. Being a missionary is blank.
Whew. Just being who you are as a Christian.
A calling? It's something that Jesus has asked all of us to do.
It's making disciples.
A challenge.
An exciting adventure.
It didn't look anything like I thought it was going to look.
Waking up every day and asking, where is the Father at work and what would He have me do?
To live out my life for Jesus in front of other people, no matter where I live.
There's nothing like it. Nothing.
I just want to, especially after that video, want to thank you for your giving throughout this last year. I asked Pat to put just a couple numbers together, and this isn't, of course, completed because the year's not over, but through your faithful giving here at Westside Baptist, we've taken in $248,244.49. I asked him to put together all that we've used for outreach, whether it be local or mission or state, North America, and of course through Lottie Moon, also our outreaches here at the church. And out of that some almost $250,000, we've put out $37,216.35 into missions here and around the world. That's through your giving. That's 15% for those of you that might be wondering. And so I want to thank you. I want to praise you. And thank the Lord for allowing us to give into His work. And your giving. You used to see these videos of real missionaries who, again, as needed as short-term mission work is, they're people that need to stay and love and live with people for years to reach them for Jesus. And you're being a part of that through your faithful giving and the cooperative program. So may the Lord bless you as you give today and the rest of your life. Brother Jason Mays, will you pray over our offering, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for reminding us that we have a small portion of our life. Thank you for allowing us to give a small portion of our life. We thank you to give back a small portion of our life. We thank you for this opportunity. We ask you to bless us to grow your kingdom. Remind us what we are in your life. Help us. Hear us for your faith. Thank you.
Bethlehem.
When we just say that name, our minds are flooded with images. We may never have been there, but it's our backdrop for the story of Christmas, year after year.
Yet long ago, before that holy night, we imagine a scene that takes place in the courts of heaven. Here the Creator prepares to become the created. And here God commissions his angel Gabriel to descend to earth.
Next, we find ourselves in Nazareth, where a devout young woman receives the news that she has been chosen by God to bear a child who will be the Son of the Most High. We see a poor carpenter awakened by an incredible dream.
And then we watch as Mary and Joseph respond to God's call on their lives. Together they set off on a journey of unwavering faith that takes them to the little town of Bethlehem and the amazing miracle waiting there.
Born in Bethlehem.
It is to Bethlehem that Naomi returned with her widowed daughter-in-law, Ruth.
In Bethlehem, Ruth met and married Boaz, and Samuel anointed a young shepherd boy named David king.
The prophet Micah foretold that one would be born in Bethlehem who would rule over Israel.
This night, in this little village just 5 miles from Jerusalem, the prophecy is fulfilled.
We watch in wonder as God sends our salvation.
Thank you. Our Savior has been born. His name is Jesus. We call him Emmanuel, God with us, Redeemer, God's only begotten Son, our Messiah, King and Lamb. Angels announce his birth to shepherds who rush to find him. And time after time, year after year, we follow those shepherds to bow at the manger and worship.
Stars are brightly shining. the night is over, and the sun rises over Bethlehem.
The silence of centuries of waiting has ended with the song of glory to God in the highest.
The world will never be the same.
God has come to us as a helpless baby.
Morning has broken, and it's the dawn of a redeeming grace.
Thank you.
a wonderful job. Superintendent of Choir, what a wonderful message. To think that God came to us in the form of a child is really amazing beyond comprehension, isn't it? And Voskamp said this years ago, "So God throws open the door of this world and enters as a baby, as the most vulnerable imaginable, because he wants unimaginable intimacy with you. What religion ever had a God that wanted such intimacy with us that he came with such vulnerability to us? What God ever came so tender that man could touch him?" 2 Corinthians 8:9 says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, though he was rich with heaven's glory, he did what? He became poor. He humbled himself. And God allowed himself to be put in this infant's body. He became poor, humble, lowly. Why? So that by his poverty you might become rich." You see, not only Christmas, but all of life revolves around the Christ child that came over 2,000 years ago and was laid in a manger. And why was he laid in a manger? Well, the scriptures tell us because there was no room for him in the inn. Now, the inn was not a Hampton. We know that. It was more like a house with guest rooms that opened their doors to travelers, especially those that had come into Bethlehem for the mandated census at this time. And of course, it was fulfilling prophecy, but that is what led Joseph and Mary there, as Joseph was of the house of Bethlehem. And it says in Luke chapter 2 and verse 7, "Then she," Mary, "gave birth to her firstborn son, and she wrapped him tightly in cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them." It's an old thought that has been preached and considered many times through the ages, but it's still timely and it's still applicable to us today. That is the thought of us making room for Jesus in our lives. At Christmas, yes, but also the Christian life is all about what we do spiritually and even with our physical body and our mind with God's greatest gift, Jesus Christ. What it means to live the Christian life, to make room for Jesus, the one sent from heaven to save us from our sins, but also who came to rescue us from an empty and wasted life. See, whether you have never really let, if you will, Jesus into your life, or whether you've been a Christian for many years, we all, not just at Christmas, but each day of our lives, we are deciding, whether we realize it or not, we decide each day if there's any room for Jesus in our lives. Do you have room for Jesus in your soul today as Savior? Do you have room for him in your physical being? Do you have room for him in your thoughts? You know, when I was little, I always pictured the innkeeper as being rude, bothered by Joseph and Mary, the coming baby. And I always pictured him as being mean for not letting an expectant mother in for their safety and well-being. However, the truth is we're not told that the innkeeper or innkeepers were any of those things. The only thing that we know is that there was no room in the inn. There was no guest room available. The innkeeper might have been polite, might have been caring, maybe even regretful that the inn was full. The innkeeper probably didn't have anything against Joseph, Mary, and the baby that was coming, but simply the house was full, and the keeper was busy hosting the others that had already filled the inn. And my point is this, that most of the world doesn't mind baby Jesus being a part of their Christmas holiday. In fact, they expect it. Most don't hate Jesus and don't mind having the nativity a part of their seasons and decorations. However, most don't have room for Jesus to be anything more than that. This week, millions will attend a worship service or services or around the world, and they'll hear the story about the baby lying in a manger, but many truly will be too busy or preoccupied to really make room for Jesus in their daily lives. That's a different story. They're not mad. They're not mad at Jesus. They're not impolite about Jesus being a part of their Christmas. They're just filled with other things. They're just full. Just preoccupied with other people, other places, other things. They're preoccupied, busy with other plans at this point in their lives. There's just no space for Jesus right now. Some are even regretful that they don't have room right now for Jesus in their life. At least, I've even had people say, I wish we could do this and that, but we just can't right now. And they might be very genuine in that moment. Maybe they just say what the innkeeper might have said. You know what? I'm sorry, but can you come back tomorrow? Or the next day? And again, I don't believe most people hate Jesus. In fact, I'm going to say at Christmas time, I believe most people or a good percentage of people around the world enjoy a little visit around the manger at Christmas time, but quickly go back into their inn, so to speak, that is full, too full to bring Jesus with them. Now, some think or may say, Jesus, come back when I get some things straightened out. But the timing just isn't good right now. Just Jesus, if you will, come back later. Days turn into weeks and weeks into years. And actually very few eventually make room for Jesus. Not only is there just no space right now, there's just no time. There's just no time. Now, naturally, if there's no room for Jesus, then there are too many guests in your life that only want their needs met. And so we have to ask ourselves today, what other guests are filling our lives right now that is not enabling Jesus to have room in our hearts? Now, I want to say this, the other guests in your life might not be sinful. I'm not insinuating that, or wicked things in and of themselves. And a matter of fact, I'm going to say this, some guests that we have in our lives might even be decent and positive things by many standards, but they keep us from making room for Jesus, and therefore in the end, they become unhealthy. And actually, they will become a curse to us. So I ask you today, and as I have to do the same thing in my life, what do you need to do to make room for Jesus in your life right now? What do you need to get rid of, so to speak? Or what do you just need to prioritize to make room for Jesus? And I implore you today that with faith you would make a decision today, this Christmas, to resolve to make room for Jesus Christ in your heart, but also in your mind, and also in your life's plan. You might be too full, too busy tending to other important guests right now, but I promise you down the road, and that could even be today, you're going to wish a million times over that you did more than just visit the stable now and then. You wish that you had made room for God's greatest gift to mankind, His only Son, our Savior. Corrie ten Boom said this, "Who can add to Christmas? The perfect motive is that God so loved the world. The perfect gift is that He gave His only Son. The only requirement is to believe in Him. The reward of faith is that you shall have everlasting life." That promise is far greater than anything else this world has to offer that might be taking up space in our lives and not allowing Jesus in. I ask you today, would you open the door of your heart, of your mind, and fill it with the most important guest of all, Jesus Christ? Father, I come to You in the precious and holy name of Jesus, asking for Your help that we might see the fullness of Christ and the emptiness of everything else that might be filling up our lives, not allowing us to know You, to know the glory of Your salvation. Holy Spirit, I'm asking You today if You will help us to see You and that we might be bold enough today to remove other things, other places, even other people to prioritize, that You may fill our lives and that we might make room for Christ. Help us, O Lord, and give us grace to do that. And Lord, then I ask that You would fill our hearts with Your glory and Your grace today. Amen. Brother Brandon is going to sing our hymn of invitation today, and I'm just going to ask if you will just to bow your heads and meditative prayer and ponder of, is there room for Jesus? And if so, is there just a little room? Is there more that needs to be made? I will be down at the altar if anyone needs to slip out. Let me lead you to Jesus Christ to pray with you for any other reason, or you can come to the altar and kneel and pray. But I pray that this Christmas season finds us more than just making a trip to the stable, but opening up the doors of our heart to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords that came to us so long ago because He loved us.
Family hiding from the storm, found no place at the keeper's door. It was for this a child was born, to save a world so cold and hollow. The sleeping town, it did not know that lying in a manger low, a Savior King who had no home has come to heal our sorrows. Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart for God to write His story? Is Shepherds counting sheep at night, do not fear the glory light. You are precious in His sight. God has come to raise the lowly. Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart for God to write His story? You can come as you are. It will set you apart when you make room in your heart and trade your dreams for His glory. Make room in your heart. Make room in your heart. Mother holds a promise tight. Every wrong will be made right. The road is straight, the burden's light. For in His hands He holds tomorrow. Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart? Is there room in your heart for God to write His story? You can come as you are. It may set you apart when you make room in your heart and trade your dreams for His glory. Make room in your heart. Make room in your heart. Make room in your heart. Make room in your heart.
All of God's children said. Amen. Wow, what a wonderful, wonderful time we've had this morning. Choir, will you stand up? Thank you so much. Miss Brenda, where are you at? Oh, there on the end. Thank you. Thank you all. Yeah. Wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you, choir. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Rest of you, if you will, stand real, keep stand with us, and we're getting ready to close. Were you all standing up anyway? I didn't even notice. About half and half. Okay. Okay. I do want to just quickly say tonight from 6 to 8, we're having a children's and youth Christmas party, and there's more information in your bulletin, and I'm thankful for several that are helping put that together, and Miss Annie and others. And so bring the youth back tonight. That's from 6 to 8. Again, there's a little more information in the bulletin. 6:30 services tonight. Tonight I'm going to finish out the series that I've been preaching on Sunday morning. And tonight is from Matthew chapter 2, 1 through 12. The gospel unites us with people from afar. Brother Aaron Hall is going to be singing tonight as well, so I do hope that you'll come back. Also in your bulletin, you find a little ticket. You take that with you, and you give that to somebody. And invite them to our Christmas Eve service. But that is for you, and so to take with you and to give to someone else. And we hope and pray that if at all possible, you'll make plans to be with us on Christmas Eve. Now, we will have services on Wednesday, planning on it, and we also will have services next Sunday morning, the day after Christmas Day. We will have Sunday school, and we will have worship service that morning, but evening will be called off. We know a lot of people are still going to be traveling and have family in and going to other places, and so we will call off that evening. And but Brother Daniel, if you will, come and thank the Lord for this great day.
Yes.
Before we leave, would you ask them to read the back page of the bulletin?
Did y'all hear that? All right, read the back page of the bulletin. I don't have one with me. What is it, Miss Rose?
It's the nimble thimbles.
Oh, yeah. The nimble thimbles. Invite you, all seniors of Westside Baptist Church, for a New Year's fellowship, December 31st, 7 till... Until the cows come home. And that'll be in the fellowship hall. And so you see the instructions. So please take that with you. And don't be alone. Come and be among friends. Thank you, Ms. Roseanne.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, how precious it is to gather with your saints. And we thank you, Lord, for coming, leaving paradise. To live in this sinful world, Lord, to be our example. Live the perfect, sinless life, Lord, to die on a cross for the redemption of mankind, Lord. May we take that message where you send us, Lord. May we be faithful and thank you for being so patient, Lord, in sanctifying us daily. May we not bring you any shame this season or in the days to come. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.